Hi, I'm Dave, a tech advocate at InfuseAI, and today I'd like to introduce PipeRider, our data reliability tool. PipeRider connects to your existing data pipeline, profiles the data, tests the quality of that data with data assertions, and produces an HTML report. In this video, I'm going to show how to connect PipeRider to an existing dbt project. So how does PipeRider help you? Well, through data profiling and assertions, PipeRider enables you to better understand your data. You can see how data changes over time and make sure that changes in data don't catch you off guard with errors making their way downstream. Data assertions allow you to test things like the number of expected columns and rows in a table, the data types of columns, that values are within a specific range, and that all values are present and there's no missing data. PipeRider comes with some out-of-the-box assertions that you can use and also has a recommended assertions feature to generate some sensible defaults based on the current state of the data. PipeRider is non-intrusive, which means it connects to your data source to run the profiler, but it won't change anything. This makes it really useful for adding data reliability testing at any stage in the pipeline without worrying about affecting your data. Currently, SQLite, Postgres, Snowflake, and dbt are supported. You just need to provide the login details when you initialize your project. And if you're using dbt, then PipeRider will automatically detect the data source settings from your data profiles. So ease of use really is one of the core concepts of PipeRider. Today I'm going to show how to add PipeRider to an existing dbt project. So we already have a dbt project set up here. The project contains some very simple transformations, nothing too complicated. So to add PipeRider to this project, all I need to do is initialize PipeRider within the dbt project folder. Now, as you can see, PipeRider has automatically detected the database settings through my dbt profile, so there's nothing else that needs to be done here. And now to double check the connection settings, I'll just run PipeRider diagnose. So we can see that PipeRider was able to connect to the database and has found my dbt models from the dbt project. If you were using another data source at this stage, such as Postgres, Snowflake, SQLite, then you would be prompted during initialization to enter the database settings, such as the credentials or the location of the database file. But as we're using dbt, everything has been configured for us. From here, all you need to do is execute PipeRider run, and PipeRider will connect to the data source and profile the data. As this is the first run, PipeRider is prompting us to generate assertion files. So PipeRider first checks if assertion files exist, and if they don't, it will prompt you to create some. Assertion files, as I said, are how you determine the quality of your data. And PipeRider provides some recommendations based on the current structure of the data. So let's take a look at one of those files. So here we can see PipeRider is asserting that the minimum number of rows for this table should be 15, the schema type for each column, and then for the name column, it's asserting that this column should be unique and it should not be null. So PipeRider generates some sensible defaults for the table. So I'll accept those. Now, because this is the first time we've run PipeRider, we can see that all the assertions have passed. Now, at this stage, we can choose to edit the assertions to change them based on what we expect the data to be. But for now, I'll leave it as the defaults. Now, because we're in a dbt project, we also have the benefit of being able to run PipeRider and also run our dbt tests as part of the PipeRider run. So now we can see that in addition to the PipeRider assertion results, we also get a dbt test section. Now I've put a test in here to deliberately fail, so we can ignore that. That just shows that the tests are working. Below that are the PipeRider recommended assertions that we already saw. And then at the bottom we have a summary, which includes the tests that passed and failed. PipeRider creates a report each time it's run. Here's the report overview for the run we just did. So we can see all the names of the tables that are in the data source. Then next to that, we have the PipeRider tests, then the dbt tests, and then some the rows and columns information for each table. So if I click through to one of these tables, we can see the profiling information for that table, the data distribution for each column. And then at the top here, we have a tests tab, which shows the results of the tests. Now this is the PipeRider assertion test that we just generated. So of course, each of these passed. Now, if we go back to the overview here, we can see that dbt test actually failed for one table for platforms. So let me click through to platforms and see what happened. Now, because this table has a DBT test associated with it, we now have a DBT test tab in the report. Now, we can scroll over and see that this particular test failed, and then we could go and find out, you know, what happened. So PipeRider has profiled the data, made some recommended assertions, and generated an HTML report. Now, let's simulate some data change and see how PipeRider handles that. So I'm going to go into my DBT project, and I'll go into the year model here, and I'm going to change it from selecting these specific columns. I'm going to select all columns, and I'm also going to add one year's worth of sales data. So as PipeRider is part of a DBT project, as I mentioned, we have access to some DBT commands from inside PipeRider. So I'm going to execute PipeRider again, but this time run DBT build as part of that process. So here we can see that some failures have occurred in the data. So we can see we now have a failure for the assert column unique assertion that's running on the year test. So something's happened between the last time we ran PipeRider and this time we added some more data. So let's take a look at the report for this run and see what we can find. So here we can see that we have a failure for DBT. We know about that happened last time. And then over here for year, we have a PipeRider assertion failure. So let's click through and take a look. So yeah, as we can see, the assert column unique has failed. Now, at this point, you might think, what's happened since the last time we ran PipeRider and this time? So we have a feature called compare reports. I'll run that now. So PipeRider enables you to select a previous report and then another report and compare those two reports together. So I'll select the last run when we knew everything had passed and then select this run where we had the failure. So now we have a comparison between the last run and this run and the failures and the past assertions. So we know we had a failure in the year table. So let's take a look in there. So looking at the schema data here, we can see that here's the extra columns that were added. So between the last time we ran PipeRider and the current run, the schema has changed and these columns have been added. So let's take a look at the tests. And we can see here's the test that failed. So on the previous run, this test passed, and on this run, the test has failed. So we know there's maybe some issue with the data. So at this point, we can pull up the data source to see what's happened. So here's the database here. I'm going to refresh the view, make sure we're looking at the latest data. And now we can see that in the name column here, there are in fact a duplication, but if we look at platform, these are for different video game platforms. One is for Game Boy, one is for NES. So we know this duplication is not a duplicate record. It's not an erroneous data. There's not been an issue. So in this case, the assertion to assert that this column should be unique, we need to change that now. Let's go back to our assertions file. And inside the PipeRider folder, we can go into the assertions folder and look for year. And now if we scroll down to name, we want to remove the assertion that asserts this column will be unique. So line 33, 34, and 35, we're going to remove. Now at this stage, you know, PipeRider also includes, in addition to the recommended assertions, you can also add your own assertions, specifying data ranges and data types that you like. So I'll add an assertion at the bottom here. So I'm going to say global sales. I'm going to add an assertion to say that we expect global sales to be within a specific range. So here what I'm saying is the maximum value for the global sales column should be between 15 and 30 million. So it should not exceed 30 million. So let's take a look how that affects our report. So now I'll rerun PipeRider. And now we can see that the year column has now failed on global sales, which was the assertion we just added. But let's scroll up and take a look. But we can see that the name, the assertion that asserts that the name column should be unique is now passing because that assertion has been removed. So let's take a look at this report. Go into the year column, year table here, and take a look at tests. So now assert the name only has two assertions, which are the type, schema type, and the value should be present, should not be null. That's fine. And then we can see here that global sales has now failed because we specified that the maximum global sales figure should be between 15 and 30 million, but actually we have a value which is 30.26 million. So this is how PipeRider can help you with understanding your data, with applying assertions, which determine what you should expect the values of your data should be. So now that the data has changed and we know about those changes and we've confirmed that everything is normal, we might want to regenerate assertions. So PipeRider has a function called generate assertions. And what this will do is regenerate recommended assertions. So let's take a look in the project. So what PipeRider's done here is made a backup of our previous assertion file and created a new recommended assertions. So now we can see that PipeRider has added a to-do into this file, which alerts us that since the last time we ran the recommended assertion and this new time we ran it, there's been a change in data and PipeRider is recommending a new value for this recommended assertion. So we can change this to 29, which asserts that for going forward, this particular table should have a minimum of 29 rows. So that's a quick overview of PipeRider. Things are moving quickly and new features being added and changed, so always check the documentation for the latest info. We have installation instructions, a command reference, a quick start guide, and also information about data assertions. If you need help, then leave a comment on the video or get in touch on Twitter. We're at InfuseAI, and I'll leave a link in the description with our community Discord so you can also get involved over there. Thanks a lot for watching, and hopefully now your data is a little bit more reliable thanks to PipeRider.